In this video, we're going to look at the stereochemistry of the Diels-Alder reaction. We're going to determine whether the products are endo or exo. And so the first thing we need to do is to define those terms, endo and exo. And they refer to relative stereochemistry of substituents. And so if I were to look at this OH group here, and I would wonder whether this is classified as being endo or exo, I need to think about that OH substituent coming off of this bridge in blue over here on the right, and compare the stereochemistry of that OH substituent to this bridge on the left in magenta. And so one way to do it would be to think about the hydrogens coming off of the bridge in magenta and the atoms coming off of the bridge in blue as being pretty much in the same plane here, creating this space or this cavity in here or this box. And the OH group is relatively inside of the box. And so we call that endo, which means inside. And so this is endo. Another way to think about it would be that at this carbon right here, this OH group is going down relative to the stereochemistry of the bridge in magenta over here as well. So that's endo. Over here on the right, we have a bicyclic compound. This time, our OH group is up at this carbon, right? So if I think about this bridge in blue, and I'm comparing the stereochemistry of my OH substituent to the bridge in magenta, once again, one way to think about it would be that, you know, these hydrogens are all on the same plane here, creating this space or this box. The OH is definitely outside of that box. And so outside, of course, is what exo means. So this is the exo substituent. Or you could think about this carbon right here and the fact that this bond is going up relative to the bridge in magenta, and so that's another way to consider it to be exo. So we have endo versus exo substituents on bicyclic compounds. Now that we understand the difference between endo and exo, let's look at a Diels-Alder reaction. And over here on the left, we have our diene, which is cyclopentadiene. All right, so this is our diene. Over here on the right, we have our dienophile. So let's go here and get some more room here. So this is our dienophile. And we can see that our dienophile is cis, right? So this is a cis dienophile. So we can even cover some stereochemistry of the dienophile in this reaction. We're going to take these two molecules, we're going to heat them up a bit, and we're going to get a Diels-Alder reaction. So let's think about this mechanism in two dimensions, and also what happens when you try to draw these molecules in three dimensions. So if I first think about this diene over here on the left, I know that these four carbons are sp2 hybridized, and I know that this carbon here in magenta is sp3 hybridized. So this molecule is mostly planar since it has all those sp2 hybridized carbons, so I'm going to attempt to draw my diene over here as being a planar molecule. So here's my diene as being planar. Go ahead and put in my double bonds like that. My dienophile is also going to be planar, right? Those four carbons right here are sp2 hybridized. So one way I could show the dienophile approaching my diene would be like this. So I can show my double bond, and then I can try to draw in my aldehydes here and try to show this as being a planar compound. So it's a little bit difficult, but imagine two planes approaching each other, right? One plane is the relatively flat diene, and the other plane is the relatively flat dienophile here. All right, now let's think about the mechanism. So we saw in the last video what the mechanism is for our Diels-Alder reaction, right? The first thing that happens would be these electrons in red. And I could think about those electrons in red moving over here to form a bond between these two carbons, right? So I could show a bond forming between those two carbons. Then I could think about my pi electrons, and I'm just going to say that these are my pi electrons. It doesn't really matter which one I choose, but these are my pi electrons here, and those are also going to move, and those are going to move into here to form a bond between these two carbons, like that. And then I could think about these electrons over here in magenta as also moving, and those electrons are going to move over to here to form a double bond. So we have a concerted 6-pi electron transition state in this Diels-Alder mechanism, and we're eventually going to form a bond between this carbon right here, which is sp2 hybridized, and this carbon down here, which is sp2 hybridized. this carbon is sp2 hybridized, and we're going to form a bond between that carbon and this carbon, which is sp2 hybridized. So if I go ahead and highlight the electrons on my drawing down here, right, the electrons in red would be these electrons. The pi electrons in blue, I'm just going to say that these are my pi electrons in blue down here. And then the electrons in magenta are these electrons right here. So if I go ahead and show the results of the movement of all of those electrons, I'm going to try to show everything in three dimensions. So I first identified this carbon right here, the sp3 hybridized carbon in magenta. That's this carbon right here. And when my sp2 hybridized carbons form bonds with each other, they're going to change to sp3 hybridized carbons, and they're going to push the bond, they're going to push the carbon in magenta up. So when I try to show the bonds form, the carbon in magenta is going to get pushed up like that, and I'm going to form bonds between what used to be my diene and my dienophile, like that. And my hydrogen is still going this way, my aldehyde is still going this way, and then down here my aldehyde is still going this way, and my hydrogen is still going this way. I also formed an alkene back here, a double bond back here. So let's follow the electrons from our mechanism, right? The electrons in red became this bond, like that. The electrons in blue became this bond right here. And the electrons in magenta became these electrons right here. And notice the hybridization states of our carbon, right? So this carbon and this carbon are now sp3 hybridized. And so we change the stereochemistry. We change what this looks like. We get this top carbon here in magenta flips up now to form a bicyclic compound. And so this Diels-Alder reaction forms a bicyclic compound. Let's go ahead and redraw it so we can identify our substituents as being either endo or exo. So if I wanted to redraw my Diels-Alder product here, so I could go ahead and sketch my bicyclic compound. Right, so it's going to look like that with a double bond back here. And let's first focus on let's focus on this carbon right here. So this carbon right here is this carbon, and I can see that the aldehyde is going to end up. Right, so the aldehyde is going to be up in the bicyclic compound on the right, and the hydrogen is going to be down after that molecule changes conformation a little bit on the left. Okay, if we look at the other carbon, the carbon over here, the one that the red is bonded to, this one, which is this one, we see the exact same thing. We see that the aldehyde is going to be up in my final product, right? So the aldehyde is going to be up in my final product. And then the other hydrogen is going to be down. And so we can see that the stereochemistry of the dienophile is retained, right? We had cis stereochemistry for our dienophile. And our two aldehyde groups are going to end up on the same side to each other, right? This one's up and this one's up. So the cis stereochemistry of the dienophile is preserved, stays cis in the products. Now, with this considered to be the endo or the exo product? Well, we can see that our aldehydes are going up. And so we know that up means the exo product. So this is the exo product for our Diels-Alder reaction. So it's possible to get those aldehydes endo to each other. So let's do this mechanism again, except let's this time show the dienophile approaching in a different way. So we're gonna show the exact same mechanism here. So we're gonna start with our diene, right? So we need to go slowly here and make sure we're trying to show our diene as being relatively planar like that. And our dienophile is also planar, but this time we're going to show the hydrogens on the right, and we're going to show the aldehydes on the left here. But we know that we have planar, right? We know this molecule is planar here, so we're going to go ahead and put this aldehyde also on the left, and then this hydrogen is over here in the right. So same mechanism, right? We know that bonds are going to form between this carbon and this carbon. We know bonds are going to form between that carbon and this carbon. We can go ahead and highlight our electrons, right? Electrons in red, right? These are my electrons, my pi electrons in blue, and put my pi electrons in magenta right here. Same thing happens, right? My sp2 hybridized carbons are going to rehybridize to form sp3 hybridized carbons here, and the carbon is going to flip up in the center there like that. And we're going to form bonds down here, like that. So just like in the previous example, the difference is this time our aldehydes are over here on the left side. So our aldehydes are over here on the left side this time, and our hydrogens are over here on the right, like that. And we need to make sure to put our double bond in there as well. So once again, when we follow what happens in our mechanism, electrons in red formed this bond, the electrons in blue formed this bond, and the electrons in magenta formed this bond right here. So we formed our bicyclic compound, but it's hard to see that this is endo, so we need to redraw it, and the molecule is going to flip up a little bit, and we're going to therefore redraw our bridge bicyclic compound. So this would be our product here. Now when we think about the stereochemistry at this carbon, this time this hydrogen is going to be up, right? So the hydrogen is going to be up this time. So hydrogen's up, and this time our aldehyde is going to be down, right? So I think that's easy to see that this aldehyde over here on the left is going to end up down for our product. So let's see if we can draw an aldehyde going down right here. And then same thing for this hydrogen right here. This hydrogen is going to be up in our final product, right? So this hydrogen is going to be, let's see if we can fit it in there. It's up. And then once again, our aldehyde is going to be down. So if we can run out of room here, but you can tell the aldehyde is going to go down here. So for our product, right, we need to make sure we have our double bond in here, and then we can analyze the stereochemistry of our substituents, our aldehyde functional groups. And so we can see that our aldehydes are going down, right? This aldehyde is going down, and this aldehyde is going down. And so we know that is the endo product. And so we have the endo product right down here. So we have exo versus endo. So which one of these two is the preferred product for this reaction? It turns out the endo product is the preferred product, and sometimes it's even the only product in this type of Diels-Alder reaction. And the reason has to do with an interaction between the carbonyls on my dienophile and the developing pi bond in my bridge bicyclic compound here. So let's see if we can point that out over here on the left. So I have these carbonyls. Right, I have these carbonyls right here, and these carbonyls are actually going to interact with this developing pi bond. So this carbonyl is also going to interact with this developing pi bond. And this involves molecular orbital theory, so I'll make sure to put a video later that specifically shows MO theory for a Diels-Alder reaction. But for right now, let's just think about the fact that those carbonyls are going to interact with that developing pi bond, and that is the reason why the endo product is preferred. If we look at the exo product and we identify our carbonyls over here, right, those are a long ways away from our developing pi bond in the mechanism, and so therefore you're not going to get any extra stabilization with your products being exo. And so endo is the preferred product and often the only product. And once again, in our second example, our dienophile, right, was cis to start with, and the aldehydes ended up on the same side for our final product, so they were cis in our final product as well. So hopefully this video shows you that the endo product is preferred. And it also shows you some of the stereochemistry of the dienophile, how if you start with a cis dienophile, you're also going to get it cis in your products.